Father, as always, we want to give you thanks, Lord, for a new day you've given us, Father God, for bringing us here together as family into your presence. Father, we thank you for the way in which you've already spoken to us in the first part of today's service. And Father, we just ask, Lord, that we will continue to hear from you. In Jesus' name, amen. I kind of feel like I could just go and sit down. I don't need to do anything else because Denzel kind of said most of what I wanted to say this morning in our talk about grace and blessings, because that's the topic for today, grace. And Denzel and I had no conversations, I'll just say. So, about acknowledging God's grace in our lives and counting our blessings. We already had a bit about the definition, or what the definition of grace is. It's in getting what we don't deserve. So God's grace is, in a sense, contrary to the ways of the world. And that can make it a bit difficult, I think, for us to understand it and at times to accept it, because the world works on the premise that in order to receive it, you need to earn it. And we can relate this to just about every area of our lives, whether it's school, work, in the sporting arena. Day in and day out, we have, you know, people, they're striving for success, wanting to achieve more, always wanting to be on top of our game, wanting to prove worth. Sometimes to earn recognition, maybe to get that bonus, sometimes simply to be accepted. And I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with having ambition or working hard and striving for success, if that's what you want to do. But if the perception is that the absence of, you know, kind of these worldly values of fame and the fortune means that we're worthless, then that is wrong, I would say. Because the world kind of tells us that those who aren't high achievers or performers, they miss out on the coveted prize. But that's not the way it works with God, is it? We don't need to perform for God. We don't need to earn it in order to receive it. And the fact is that even if we tried, we really never could. So though we don't deserve it, the Lord gives freely to us out of his unconditional love for us. And that's grace. So I'd like us today just to look at a group of people to whom God's grace was evident. The Israelites. So I take it that most of us are familiar with the story of how God's children were enslaved in Egypt by Pharaoh for many years, and how God raised up Moses to deliver them. That we're familiar with the drama surrounding their deliverance, which included the plagues, the death of Pharaoh's son, and the dramatic parting of the Red Sea. Yes? Yes. Okay, lovely. So, following that, the people, they sang a song of deliverance unto the God who had just rescued them. So we pick up the story at Exodus 15, verse 22 to 27. Then Moses led Israel from the Red Sea, and they went into the desert of Shur. For 3 days, They traveled in the desert without finding water. When they came to Marah, they could not drink its water because it was bitter, and that's why they called the place Marah. So the people grumbled against Moses, saying, "What are we to drink?" Then Moses cried out to the Lord, and the Lord showed him a piece of wood. He threw it into the water, and the water became fit to drink. There the Lord issued a ruling and instruction for them and put them to the test. He said, "If you listen carefully to the Lord your God and do what is right in his eyes, if you pay attention to his commands and keep all his decrees, I will not bring on you any of the diseases I brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you." Then they came to Elim, where there were 12 springs and 70 palm trees, and they camped there near the water. Let's jump to Exodus 16, verse 1 to 8, and then verse 35. The whole Israelite community set out from Elim and came to the desert of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they had come out of Egypt. In the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. In this way, I will test them and see whether they will follow my instructions. On the sixth day, they are to prepare what they bring in, and that is to be twice as much as they gather on other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "In the evening, you will know that it was the Lord who brought you out of Egypt. And in the morning, you will see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your grumbling against him. Who are we that you should grumble against us?" Moses also said, "You will know that it was the Lord when he gives you meat to eat in the evening and all the bread you want in the morning, because he has heard your grumbling against him. Who are we? You're not grumbling against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses told Aaron, "Say to the entire Israelite community, come before the Lord, for he has heard your grumbling." While Aaron was speaking to the whole Israelite community, they looked toward the desert, and there was the glory of the Lord appearing in the cloud. The Lord said to Moses, "I have heard the grumbling of the Israelites. Tell them, at twilight you will eat meat, and in the morning you will be filled with bread. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God." So that evening, quail came and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the dew was gone, thin flakes like frost on the ground appeared on the desert floor. When the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, "It is the bread the Lord has given you to eat. This is what the Lord has commanded. Everyone is to gather as much as they need. Take an omer for each person you have in your tent." The Israelites did as they were told. Some gathered much, some little. And when they measured it by the omer, the one who had gathered much did not have too much, and the one who had gathered little did not have too little. Everyone had gathered just as much as they needed. The Israelites ate manna 40 years, until they came to the land that was settled. They ate manna until they reached the border of Canaan. So God gave them exactly what they needed, not too much and not too little. We go to Exodus 17 and we pick up at verse 1. The whole Israelite community set out from the desert of Sin, traveling from place to place as the Lord had commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. So they quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses replied, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you put the Lord to test?" But the people were thirsty for water there, and they grumbled against Moses. "Why did you bring us up out of Egypt to make us and our children and livestock die of thirst?" Then Moses cried out to the Lord, "What am I to do with these people? They're almost ready to stone me." The Lord answered Moses, "Go out in front of the people, take with you some of the elders of Israel, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and go. I will stand there before you by the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock, and water will come out of it for people to drink." So Moses did this in the sight of the elders of Israel, and he called the place Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and because they tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" Complaints and complaints. The Lord provides for his nation of complainers. We'll go to chapter 32, but before we do that, now let's look at chapter 24. Verse 12 to 14, where the Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain and stay here, and I will give you the tablets of stone with the law and commandments I have written for their instruction." Then Moses set out with Joshua, his aide, and Moses went up on the mountain of God. He said to the elders, "Wait here for us until we come back to you. Aaron and Hur are here with you, and anyone involved in a dispute can go to them." So, Exodus chapter 32. When the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said, "Come, make us gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses, who brought us out of Egypt, we don't know what's happened to him." Aaron answered them, "Take off the gold earrings that your wives, your sons, and your daughters are wearing and bring them to me." So all the people took off their earrings and brought them to Aaron. He took what they had handed to him and made it into an idol cast in the shape of a calf, fashioning it with a tool. Then they said, "These are your gods, Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of the calf and announced, "Tomorrow there'll be a festival to the Lord." So the next day, the people rose early and sacrificed burnt offerings and presented fellowship offerings. Afterward, they sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Go down, because your people, whom you brought out of Egypt, have become corrupt. They have been quick to turn away from what I commanded them and have made themselves an idol cast in the shape of a calf. They have bowed down to it and sacrificed to it and have said, 'These are your gods, who Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt.' I have seen these people, the Lord said to Moses, and they are a stiff-necked people. Now leave me alone, that my anger may burn against them and that I may destroy them. Then I will make you into a great nation. But Moses sought the favor of the Lord his God. Lord, he said, why should your anger burn against your people from whom you brought out of Egypt with great power and a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say it was with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and wipe them off the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce anger, relent, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember your servants, Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, to whom you swore by yourself, I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and I will give your descendants all this land I promised them, and it will be their inheritance forever. Then the Lord relented and did not bring on his people the disaster he had threatened. The Lord changed his mind. Though they deserved punishment, he didn't do it. So maybe a little gratitude wouldn't go amiss here, would it? Because for how long do we count our blessings? I'd probably say that maybe if the Israelites' example isn't anything to go by, not for very long. Because they were happy to be rescued from the clutches of Pharaoh. They sang their song of deliverance following the victory at the Red Sea. But how quickly their tune changed at the first hurdle. And I'd like to think that, well, just play around with this a little bit, that then after singing that song and they came to the first hurdle, then they sang a different song. Their tune changed. And they composed many different versions of the same song. You know, one that says, we shall all complain. We shall all complain. We shall all complain today. Whenever we don't have what we need, we will just complain again. Well, it seems like it. You know, let's forget about the fact that the Lord came through for us, that he's with us, has been providing for us on a daily basis, bread in the morning, meat in the evening, water to drink, pillar of cloud to guide and shield us from the scorching sun in the day, pillar of fire to light the way at night. Oh, how easy it is to focus on what's missing and misplace our focus. But I think, like us, the Israelites got disheartened when the journey got a little bit rough. Despite all that God had done for them and how he had proved himself to be faithful and loving, they began to doubt him. The same God who came through for them big time, they began to doubt him to the point of wanting to return to their old way of life, a life of being enslaved. But somehow, I don't think that that's a difficult situation to be given, to be in, given that the Israelites were in the desert for 40 years. If we were to look back on our lives, possibly over 10, 15, 20 years, would we be able to say, hand on heart, that's not me? I can't. When Moses went up to the mountain, the Israelites were left at a place of waiting. They waited, and they waited. 40 whole days and nights, and nothing. What do we do when we're at that place of waiting? When we've been praying, seeking God, and it seems like He's not there. When we're waiting on an answer or a decision that's not forthcoming, maybe when another option presents itself. How easy is it to get back to the old way of thinking, that old way of being, that old way of doing? Falling back into old habits or addictions? Very easy, I would say. Because it's not easy being at the place of waiting, is it? But sometimes it can be good for us. Because there might be things that we need to learn, areas of our lives that need to be worked on. We might not see it at the time, but sometimes it's good for us. When I became pregnant with Caden, which is almost 10 years ago now, and I remember we began asking God to make finances available for us to convert the loft, because we only had a two-bedroom house. We couldn't afford to move house. I didn't think that God was saying that we should move house. So we started praying and asking. We remained in that place of waiting for 8 long years. And in that time, you know, lots of stuff going on in your head. Is this ever going to happen? Is there anything else that I need to do? I mean, apart from trying to work and save, is there anything that I need to do in order to move things forward? You get all these thoughts going on. But 8 years later, God came through and exceeded our expectations. And I think maybe amongst other things, the lesson there was about trust, patience, perseverance. But it wasn't easy. And as humans, we like easy. I'll be the very first to admit I like easy. Nothing wrong with that, is there? No, I like easy. But did God promise us easy? Yeah, He most certainly didn't. Because where does it say on our journey with Him we will only have smooth sailing ahead? I don't recall reading that anywhere. In fact, I'd say we're more likely guaranteed turbulence, pitfalls, steep mountains, deep waters. But the best guarantee of all is that our Heavenly Father is there, looking after us, providing for us, even when we don't recognize it. And when the journey seems hard, He's there. When I was about 4 years old, our house burnt down and we lost everything. Apparently the fire was started when a neighbor left a candle burning, possibly by the window, and the wind blew and it caught. And these houses were wooden houses, so the fire spread quite rapidly. And my most vivid memory of that night was running down the road, barefooted, with my siblings. And we must have stopped at some point and turned and had a look around. And I remembered seeing 3 items thrown over the fence. There was a refrigerator, my mother's Singer sewing machine, and a green speaker box that I think we still have to this day. To this day, I'm not sure who the strong man or woman was who was throwing them things over, but Apart from the clothes on our backs, we lost everything in the fire that night. To this day, I won't use a candle in my house unless I really, really have to. That's my phobia. I don't. And if I have to use one, it's never left unattended. So my parents had to start over with five children, ranging from ages 2 to 10 years. And unlike here in the UK, there's no welfare system to turn to. It's just the goodwill of family and friends. And houses were not insured either, so there's no compensation to be had. So, the seven of us moved to my grandmother's already fully occupied house. And that's where we grew up, because my parents couldn't afford to buy or rebuild. I mean, that's still the case for a lot of people back home in Jamaica now. Not everybody can afford to buy a house or to make one. But though I was young, I knew things were difficult for my parents. My father is a cabinet maker, my mother a dressmaker. And sometimes the work just wasn't there. Hence, we were poor. But we were also happy. We were loved and looked after. And one of the things I remember for sure is that we never went to bed hungry. Mommy always made sure there was something on the table for us to eat. It might not have been what we wanted to eat, but there was still something. And we were always, always giving God thanks for his provision. And I can't really recall hearing my parents constantly complaining about their situation. Maybe they did it when we weren't around, because there's this tendency not to speak everything for children to hear, because you don't want them to take your business out onto the street. So, yeah, I still hold to that to this day. Or maybe I just don't remember them doing it. But I suppose for me, reflecting on God's grace and looking at the story of the Israelites, it highlighted the fact that God rescued me and my family from the fire that night. And though the next few years were difficult, those were the years that really helped to shape my life, I think. In the way that I view things, people, some of the skills I've developed, some of the lessons I've learned, some of the experiences I've had. The fact that I was made to go to church because I was living there with my grandmother. Well, that worked out okay, didn't it? And though I can hand on heart say that, you know, my childhood years weren't all bad, growing up in the ghetto where you have so many challenges, so much stuff to bring you down on a daily basis, you need something positive to focus on, something to, you know, kind of uplift your spirit. And I think that has really helped me to learn how to count my blessings, because when you're living there, you realize how bad it is, but still that it could be worse. Which is why, you know, sometimes people hear me say I'm too blessed to be stressed. It's not that I'm up myself. It's just, you know, trying to recognize God's blessings, God's grace in my life, and giving him praise for that. And I do understand, you know, that for some, it's easier said than done. For most of us, I know, especially for me and for Barry as well, our children are a lot more privileged than we were. And I do thank God for that. I really do. But there are some aspects of my childhood that I would have loved for them to experience, because then it would possibly give them a greater appreciation, you know, and understanding of the value of life. On the other hand, there are aspects of my childhood that I would never want anyone, let alone my children, to experience. But I think that though, you know, we're growing up in different cultures, it is still good to instill the values and remind them to be thankful Learn to count their blessings. Try to focus on the positives of what you have rather than the negatives of what you don't have, because then you kind of miss out enjoying life, I'd say. But then to what extent are we inclined to do this? A lot of the times, it is easier said than done. Because for some of us, it's the natural default mode. If everything is not going okay, it can seem, you know, like we're constantly, it's just a battle and constantly whinging and whining. Whereas I think it's good sometimes just to take a step back, just to recall, just to reflect. And then we can see clearly, you know what? God has done this in my life. God is doing this in my life. And then be able to thank him for it. And that is how we start to count our blessings, learn to count our blessings. And I know I've been talking about what complain and stuff, but let me just, in a sense, clarify that simply being honest about what you're going through, that's not what this is about. That's not about complaining. Because we all go through stuff in life. And just simply saying, you know what, at this time, I'm just really, really having a rubbish time. That's not what. I think with complainers, sometimes, you know, you have some people, every time you see them, there's something for them to talk about. Nothing, there's never a sunny side up. That's what this is about. Just being able to just take a step back and say, yeah, this is not going right, but you know what? And it's true that, you know, there are times, depending on what we're going through, it's really, really difficult to see what God is doing. Really difficult. In fact, sometimes it's so much easier to talk about what the devil is doing. Because I know sometimes, and nobody in this church, but I know some Christians for whom everything, oh yes, it's the plan of the enemy, that's why this is happening to me, and it's this and it's that. And I mean, we do recognize that the enemy is there trying to get us, but I'd say, you know, just a word of caution, because if we know that as Christians, the devil is constantly out to get us, has no good plans for us, and we'll be really, really pleased when things go wrong. Yet we spend more time talking about all that the devil is getting up to rather than what God is doing in our lives. Then it kind of just makes me wonder, whose praises are we singing? So I'll just say, you know, just a word of caution. You recognize it, but God, what is God doing? A few months ago, I was sharing the story about the Israelites with my kids, Brianna and Caden, whilst they were having breakfast. They were probably whinging about something. And I thought, yeah, I'm going to share this with you. And whilst as they're talking about to them, God spoke to me. As plain as day, he does that sometimes. Sometimes I wish he would do it all the time. Maybe I couldn't handle it if he did it all the time, so. But as plain as day, he said to me, but I never left them. I never left them. And that is so important for us to remember when we're facing times of difficulty or perceived difficulty. God is still there. He hasn't left his children. He never left them. And that struck me when he reminded me of that. And even though we might find it hard to believe, because, like I said, sometimes we really don't feel like he's there. We can't see what it is that he's doing. If we think for a moment sometimes on why it is that we possibly can't see or feel, what's going on. He hasn't left us. Have we left him? So that we can say, well, no, I haven't. I still pray. I still come to church. I still tithe. I still do all the things that I do. Could that be down to just going through the motions? It might become a little bit clearer. As a parent, I've developed this really cool skill called selective hearing. Now, most evenings, I have to work from home in order to make up my hours because I'm from doing the school run. And whilst I'm there, I can be working away, and the kids will come in for a chat or a whinge. And whilst they're there, and they're talking to me, and I'm working, and you might get a few responses, grunts, nods. And as far as they're concerned, we're having this conversation. But the truth is, depending on the intensity of what I'm doing, my mind is totally elsewhere. My focus is not really with what's going on there with them. I don't do it all the time. I do make time to talk to my kids. But the physical me is carrying on as mom should. But they can't see what's happening on the inside, can they? And I'd say sometimes the same can be true of us when we're up against it. We go through the physical motions of everyday life, we carry on, but then what consumes our thoughts? Where is our focus at the difficult time? I know certainly I'm not always thinking about the fact that God has come through for me before. Because you know what? Gosh, this one is a real biggie, you know? And I just can't see any way out of it. I've been talking to God about it, but he seems very quiet. And I kind of need a response like yesterday. So, I can't really hang around and wait for God. Let me just try and figure it out for myself. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to think really, really hard about this problem day and night. Then I'm going to worry constantly about what it is that I'm going to do. In fact, I might even have some sleepless nights about it as well. Actually, maybe I'll go talk to my friend down the road. Oh, no, maybe not, because you can't deal with people knowing my business all the time, you know? The best thing is for me to try and work it out. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to think really, really hard about this problem day and night. Then I'm going to worry constantly about what it is that I need to do. I might even have some sleepless nights over it as well. I wonder if I should probably talk to maybe the pastor or something. Nah, can't deal with people knowing my business all the time. It's best that I try to figure this one out. And we go around in that cycle. And in a sense, this is what I mean when I say that, have we left him? Because our focus has shifted. We're no longer looking to God as our problem solver. But we begin to look more at the problem, how we can solve it. And in making that our focus, it's extremely hard to see anything else. Now, I mean, I can talk from experience, but I'm sure you don't need me standing here to say how incredibly easy it is to do this. When we get weighed down by life's struggles, if we're not careful, we can also get blinded by it, because the natural tendency will be to magnify the problem and minimize God's ability to solve it. The songwriter says, "I have made you too small in my eyes. Oh Lord, forgive me. And I have believed in a lie that you were unable to help me." The chorus of the song says, "Be magnified, O Lord. You are highly exalted, and there's nothing you can't do. O Lord, my eyes are on you. Be magnified." In the midst of what's going on, where are our eyes today? The Israelites were naturally concerned about their daily needs, as we all are. What will I eat? What will I drink? Will I have enough? From the snippets that we've read from the story, we can see out of concern for themselves, they forgot about how God their Father had rescued them, how he always provided for their needs, even during the times when they complained against him, turned away from him, and engaged in pagan revelry, which deserved punishment. But out of his unconditional love for his children, God relented. He remained ever faithful. He never left them. And as his children today, he hasn't left us. You saw the suffering of our ancestors in Egypt. You heard their cry at the Red Sea. You sent signs and wonders against Pharaoh, against all his officials and all the people of his land. For you knew how arrogantly the Egyptians treated them. You made a name for yourself, which remains to this day. You divided the sea before them so that they passed through it on dry ground, but you hurled their pursuers into the depths like a stone into the mighty waters. By the day, you led them with a pillar of cloud, and by night, a pillar of fire to give them light on the way they were to take. You came down on Mount Sinai. You spoke to them from heaven. You gave them the regulations and laws that are just and right, and decrees and commands that are good. You made known to them your holy Sabbath and gave them commands and decrees and laws through your servant Moses. In their hunger, you gave them bread from heaven, and in their thirst, you brought them water from the rock. You told them to go in and take possession of the land you had sworn with uplifted hand to give them. But they, our ancestors, became arrogant and stiff-necked, and they did not obey your commands. They refused to listen and failed to remember the miracles you performed among them. They became stiff-necked and in their rebellion appointed a leader in order to return to their slavery. But you are a forgiving God, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. Therefore, you did not desert them. Even when they cast for themselves an image of a calf and said, 'This is your God who brought you up out of Egypt,' or when they committed awful blasphemies. Because of your great compassion, you did not abandon them in the wilderness. By day, the pillar of cloud did not fail to guide them on their path, nor the pillar of fire by night to shine on the way they were to take. You gave your good spirit to instruct them. You did not withhold your manna from their mouths, and you gave them water for their thirst. For 40 years, you sustained them in the wilderness. They lacked nothing. Their clothes did not wear out, nor did their feet become swollen. That's all God. That's all God. He provides. He's there. He didn't leave them in the wilderness. And he'll not leave us in all wilderness. I've just read to you from Nehemiah 9. Verse 9 to 19. The chapter then goes on to tell of the cycle of disobedience and God turning them over to the hands of their enemies. They would cry out to God, and out of his unconditional love and compassion, he'd deliver them. This is the next generation of Israelites who've taken the time to gather, to confess, to recall the goodness of God, something their predecessors didn't do very well. And though they came together as a nation, it must then have impacted on their individual lives, because in order for you to stand and make that proclamation about God, you must know for yourself that this is the God who has done this. So I'd say, let us try to learn the lessons from our brothers and sisters. Let us try to develop an attitude of gratitude. As we look around our world, there is just so much stuff that we can be down about. So much stuff that we can complain about. But we should remember, our Father in heaven is looking after us. He's with us. He's providing for us. Let us not lose sight of that. His great provisions for waking us up this morning, for the air that we breathe, for the food that he gives us to eat, even if it's not steak on the plate, for the roof over our heads, whether it's a mansion or a hut, the clothes on our backs, whether they're brand name or no name. The family and friends he's blessed us with, even the ones we don't love as much as we should. Or health, even when we have a few aches and pains. Or jobs, even the ones we don't enjoy doing. Or finances, regardless of how little or how much. At times when it seems like we only work to pay the bills, stop and think, what would happen if I weren't able to pay those bills? I feel a thank God there, somewhere in there. I'd like to challenge us today that each time we stop to say how rubbish our lives or situations are, in the midst of that, just think of one good thing that God has done. Something that we can give God thanks for. It's not always easy. It's not always easy. It requires practice, I'd say. Just one good thing to thank God for. This is rubbish, but God is doing that. Practice, but it's not impossible. And in doing that, time and again and time and again, I think we just might find that when our focus changes a bit, so will our outlook. And that will help us to acknowledge God's grace in our lives and start counting our blessings. We'll always find something that's not going right. But let's learn to count our blessings. Our God is faithful. He's with us. He'll never leave us. He provides for us. Let's just thank Him for that. I'll finish by reading from Matthew 6. If God gives such attention to the appearance of wildflowers, most of which are never ever seen, don't you think He'll attend to you, take pride in you, do His best for you? What I'm trying to do here is to get you to relax, not to be so preoccupied with getting, so you can respond to God's giving. Father, we pray that you will help us going forward to count our blessings. We thank you for your grace, Father God. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your mercy. Help us to acknowledge all these things in our lives, O God, and to give you the thanks, to give you the praise, to give all glory to you, because you truly and only you deserve that. Thank you for loving us. Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.